Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. All the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. And I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. And I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Only overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. And I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I found, leaves in 99, and I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99, and I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
To love you, I may be seated. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, strive eagerly for the greatest spiritual gifts, but I shall show you a still more excellent way. If I speak in human and angelic tongues, but do not have love, I am a resounding gong and a clashing cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and comprehend all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own, and if I hand my body over to be burned, but do not have love, then I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. It is never jealous or rude or boastful or conceited or selfish. It is not quick-tempered and does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth, and it bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things. Love never fails. The word of the Lord. And now we pray with you as we begin this celebration. Father, we ask you to hear our prayers as we gather to celebrate with Jack and Ashton. You've brought them together. When you created mankind, you willed that man and wife should be one. We ask you to bind Ashton and Jack together in the loving union of marriage and make their love fruitful so that they may be living witnesses to your divine love in the world. We ask this in Christ our Lord.
Today we gather as family and friends to celebrate one of life's greatest joys. That is, two people who love each other come together to celebrate life forever. The good news is that marriage and family was God's idea. I think it was a really good idea. The Bible tells us in Genesis that God created the heavens and the earth and everything, and he took a step back and said that it was good. And then the Bible says that God created man out of dust, and he noticed something that was different, something he didn't like, and that was that man was alone. And God said, this is not good. So he caused man to fall into a deep sleep, and out of the side he took a rib and he formed and he fashioned the first woman. And Adam looked at Eve and said, this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. And God said, this is good. You see, we were meant to live in community, in relationships. We were created by God for God, and it works when we do life together, particularly in the context of a marriage relationship. It's not just two people coming together who love each other until death do them part. It is also a picture of Christ and the church and grace and mercy and love and forgiveness. Jack and Ashton, they met. They hung out for a while and they dated. And then they fell in love. Jack asked Ashton to marry him, and she said yes. And today, we're here to celebrate what God has brought together. Two people who met and fell in love. Now they're standing before family and friends, and they are committing their lives to each other only until death do them part. For thousands of years, humanity has celebrated this ordinance, this time together. And so what we're doing today is normal and natural and a part of humankind. It's a wonderful thing when two people find each other and they fall in love. Jack and Ash, and I would say to both of you that long before either one of you were born, God knew that on this day, in front of family and friends, you would commit your life to each other until death do you part. So this is not an accident. This is not coincidence. They believe God has brought them together for such a time as this. And so today we know that God is a giver of every good and perfect gift, and marriage is a wonderful gift. It was God's idea, a really good idea. So today we thank him for it. Paul was trying to help us understand what this union looks like. When he wrote to the church at Ephesus, he said, "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself." Paul goes on to write, "This is a profound mystery, for I'm talking about Christ and the church." So today we come to celebrate the union of these who fell in love and love each other as a gift from God, something that he has brought together that all of us can rejoice. With that being said, who gives this woman to be married to this man? The truth is, half the battle is getting here, and you arrived. Jack and Aston, what a joy it is for me to stand before you today as you begin your journey and your life together. In just a few minutes, you will no longer be single adults. You will be married. You will be husband and wife. And that's a wonderful thing. If there were ever two people meant to be together, it's the two of you. It's been a joy for me to get to know you and to be a part of this day. And I want you to know that I think the two of you will do great things for each other and for God. And you'll make a great team. And that's a wonderful thing. Jack, God has given the male, the husband, the responsibility to lead. In the family, the function of leadership is to lead. And as you lead your family, God's going to honor that. He's going to bless that. And it'll make marriage all that it needs to be. What I know about Ashton is that if you lead in that way, she will come right alongside you, and you're much better together than you are individually. That's what marriage is all about. It's a give and take and working together that the two of you are stronger than each one of you by yourself. And so Ashton, Jack said that he loves your smile. That when you walk in a room, it lights up. I would agree with that. He says he loves your personality, your warm hugs, and how you love those around you, give yourself away, and how you love your family. That's something he admires greatly about you. Jack, Ashton says she loved your smile as well. Y'all got some things in common. Your personality. But one thing she said that I think is a great attribute, she says, you are a true gentleman. And she loves that about you, your kindness of heart and the way that you treat other people. And that means a lot to her. And that's a wonderful characteristic to have. So don't ever lose that. Love your wife as Christ loved the church. And when you do that, it makes marriage work. The good news is you've seen other people do marriage and you know what it looks like. And so now you're about to take the journey yourself. And so I know that everyone gives you good advice about what that looks like. So let me just jump in there very quickly and give you mine. I promise you that if you'll do these three things, 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now, you'll look back and you won't regret being here today. You will say it's the best decision we ever made. The first thing you need to know is that marriage takes three. That is, it takes both of you and it takes Jesus Christ as a foundation of your home and your marriage. The truth is, marriage is hard work. You have to work at it all the time, but that's what makes it good. And it's so much better in so many ways when you're working together. The truth is that there will be days when the marriage will be wonderful, and there will be days when there will be challenges. That's part of life. But when you have Jesus Christ in the center of your marriage, when the wind and the rain comes and the challenges come, you will be able to stand together because you've made a commitment in that way. So go ahead and decide as you begin your life together to make Jesus Christ a firm foundation of your home. Anchor your life and your marriage with that, and you won't go wrong. Number two, remember that the vows that you're about to take in a moment, they mean something to God and they mean something to you. We live in a world where people make promises and they don't keep them. But when we come before family and friends and before God and we pledge our lives to each other, it's a commitment. And so just remember that going forward, that it means something to you and it means something to God. The last thing I would say is make sure that you remember that your relationship with Jesus Christ will make you a better partner in the marriage. Jack is going to make you a better husband. Ashton, it'll make you a better wife. What I mean by that is your identity is in Christ. You cannot look to your spouse to fill every need that you have. That's an unrealistic expectation. Your identity, your love, all the things that go with making life work is in that relationship with Christ. And out of the overflow of that, you can love each other, you can forgive each other, you can work together as a couple because that's the way God put it together. So, if you'll put Jesus Christ first, remember the vows that you're about to take mean something. And out of the overflow of that love relationship with Christ, you're able to be all that you need to be. God will honor the home and the marriage, and you will be glad you were here today. And so I wish you the best as you move forward, that God's blessings and His mercy and His grace will fill your home and your marriage. With that being said, let's turn now and face each other, and we will exchange our vows. So if you'll hold hands and look at each other, you'll repeat after me. Jack, you'll go first. And so if you'll repeat after me as you look at Ashton. I, Jack.
I, Jack.
Take you, Ashton.
Take you, Ashton.
To be my lawful wedded wife.
To be my lawful wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
For sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Until death do us part.
Until death do us part.
Ashton, if you'll repeat after me. I, Ashton.
I, Ashton.
Take you, Jack.
Take you, Jack.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
Have and to hold.
For better, for worse.
Better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and
to love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Until death do us part.
Until death do us part.
In ancient days, rings were used to seal a contract by a king. He would write a document, he would take his ring, put it in the wax, and he would seal the document. The only one who could open the document was the one who had authority to do that. And so he would open the document as it was sealed. Rings don't make you married. It lets everybody know that you are. And so the great thing about rings is it is a constant and consistent reminder that on this day you pledged your love to each other until death do you part. And so from now until that time comes, every day take a moment, look at the ring, and remember what God has brought together. I have the rings. Thank you. Thank you. So, Jack, if you'll take Ashton's ring, put it on her left ring finger, hold it there. I'll go all the way with it. Yeah, there you go. And repeat after me. With this ring.
With this ring.
I give you my life.
I give you my life.
My commitment.
My commitment.
My love to you.
My love to you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
The Son.
The Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Ashton, if you'll take Jack's ring, put it on his left ring finger there, over there. There you go. Slide that off. There you go. Perfect. And repeat after me. With this ring.
This ring.
I give you my life.
I give you my life.
My commitment.
My commitment.
My love to you.
My love to you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
The Son.
Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Now, marriage is not just two people coming together who love each other. Certainly, that is a picture that we celebrate today, but it's so much more than that. The Bible tells us that a man will leave his mother and father, and the two will become one flesh. That's the way God put it together and designed it. But it's also bringing two families together who will share life together, and that's what makes it such a wonderful gift. And so as Jack and Ashton now transition to light the unity candle, we are reminded that as they come together as husband and wife, so will the families come together and celebrate what God has brought together. You guys can light the unity candle now.
So we'll be saved.
Would you join me as we pray together? Father, what a joy it is to know that you are the giver of every good and perfect gift. Marriage and family and relationships was your idea. You have blessed us with those that we love, and they add so much to our lives. Father, we stand here today and we thank you for Jack and Ashton and their love for you and their love for each other. I ask your blessings on their home and their marriage as they begin this journey together. First of all, they will make you the foundation of their home and their marriage and their life together, that everything that they see and say and do would bring honor and glory to you. I pray that they would understand that the vows and the commitments they've shared here today in front of family and friends, they mean something to you and they mean something to each other. I pray that they will continue to love each other as Christ loved the church. And I pray, Father, that as they grow to love you more and more each and every day, that they would grow to love each other the way you designed marriage to be, that a husband would love his wife and his wife would love her husband. And so thank you for giving us that model, for helping us to know your plan and design. And so I pray your blessings on them as they begin this life together, that they will honor you in their home and in their marriage. Bless them in the days to come. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, by the power invested in me as a minister of the gospel in accordance with the laws of the state of Mississippi, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Jack, you may kiss your bride. Turn around, yeah. And they're going to fix your thing over here. Perfect. So we get just for a minute.
Woo!
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor and my privilege to introduce to you today for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Jack Girard. Thank you. Jack and Ashton, thank you so very much for coming and being a part of this day. The reception is at the Bridalwood of Madison. The address is on your program. Thank you for coming. Have a wonderful evening. God bless. All right.
This is insane.
What are we doing? Yeah,
good
bugs.
Let's go, brother.
I'm a white
country.
That's right.
That's right.
Oh, that's Carson for sure.
Jarrett Country.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
Somebody has your last name.
Huh?
Somebody has your last name.
I know.
I don't find them way over here.
No! Hold your ring up.
Yeah, hold that ring up.
Three, two, one.
Yes, sir.
Andrew!
Could at least do it.
Andrew!
Yeah, what the five?
Hey, it's five gang now.
Oh, fuck that.
Okay, so before y'all get accosted, go to the bride's room.
Bride's room?
Go on. Go.